Yeah, it's really good. So, good morning, everybody, and welcome. I'm absolutely delighted to see you all here this morning. One way or another, we've had a little bit of a bumpy ride getting here, but absolutely delighted that we're here in this rather splendid environment. And in terms of claiming our space, we've certainly got a great space to be claiming it in. So, we haven't got endless amounts of time, so just to let you know a few sort of key points of how we're going to proceed this morning. My name is Julia Long. I'm going to be chairing the event this morning. I'm also going to be giving a brief introduction to the legislative context within which this discussion is going to be happening this morning. I'm delighted to welcome to my right here Ruth Savotka, who is I'll let her introduce herself because I'm doing it briefly, but she's a very active, she's got a very long and great tradition of trade union activism.
Seth's co-convener with another trade union colleague of Socialist Feminist Network, which we've just set up recently, and also I'm one of the organisers of the new campaign, A Woman's Place, which is hoping that we can have an impact on the consultation process around gender identity.
Okay, that's great, thanks. Thank you. And to my left here, I have Stephanie Debussarai, who I'm delighted to introduce. She's probably aware, she's the author of Communicating with Kids, and she's a consultant on those kind of issues around communication skills, and she also is a co-runner of the website Transgender Trend, which is a website for parents concerned about issues of transgenderism, particularly as they affect children. But I'd like to begin the event by welcoming one of the organisers to say a few words of introduction herself, because for the organisers it's certainly been a bit of a journey from the 13th of September, which I think is a date that's going to go down in history in terms of what we all witnessed at Skinner's Corner. So thanks very much.
Hi.
Because I'm aware that some people will be wanting to go to the other slightly less exciting event up the road. So what we're going to do, we're going to have a natural break within the event at 11:45, so that anyone who feels that they're able to tear themselves away, I doubt that there is going to be anyone in that position, but if anyone does feel that they're going to tear themselves away, then we'll have that break and the rest of us will continue to discuss these events more fully. So we won't, I think for the time being, be picking up on some of the really very important issues that we need to talk about in terms of what we witnessed a couple of weeks ago and some of the social media response to that and the general atmosphere of a really tyrannical atmosphere of trying to silence women, even to the extent of celebrating violence in that attempt. We'll have a chance to talk about that a bit later. So I'm going to try and speak fairly concisely about the legislative developments that have led us to the point now where we're having this discussion. Because I'm aware, you know, when you hear politicians talking about this issue, it becomes very apparent to me that actually there's a huge amount of confusion. People are confusing things like, you know, this new term of gender identity with sexuality. There's all kinds of confusion around terminology, unsurprisingly, I would say. But I just thought it might be something that's worthwhile for all of us to take stock a little bit as to where we are and how we got to this point and what we might want to be, doing about it. So in terms of the talk, I'm going to be starting off with a very brief overview of the Gender Recognition Act of 2004, moving through the developments within this country, through the Equality Act of 2010, and up to this point where we've now got this proposed review of the Gender Recognition Act this coming autumn. And I'll also be just saying a little bit about the international context around that, which has helped to kind of set the agenda for the kinds of terminology, the kinds of new legislation that some governments, such as our own, seem rather hasty to want to introduce. So then, if we go back then to the 2004 Gender Recognition Act, this act in its day was seen as a very pioneering piece of legislation because it was the first law that granted legal rights to be for an individual to be recognised in this term that the act uses of their acquired gender. Now, we could spend the rest of the day talking about the rather problematic notion of an acquired gender, because as Trixie has pointed out, feminists, and not just feminists, but generally sociologists and other social scientists, do not understand gender as some kind of inherent innate property of the individual. That has not been the accepted definition of this word gender. So I think we do need to be quite clear that in terms of the various of legislation, going back to the 2004 Act, the terminology is extremely problematic. And what we're seeing now is an acceleration in terms of the new terminology that's coming in. But all of it is based on this rather problematic notion that we have this thing called a gender identity, or that we're able to determine our gender, when actually, what the law is seeking to do is to grant individuals rights, and not on the basis of gender, which is a social construct. When we talk about gender, we're talking about all the kinds of different behaviours, social roles, the kinds of treatment that we can expect to get and that are expected of us when we either have a male or a female body. That is how social scientists and feminists understand that term gender. It's a social and political construct that has got very, very serious implications for women, I would say, in particular. And then we understand the term sex as a biological term that is indicative of, you know, that is used to indicate whether someone has male or female anatomy, chromosomes, etc. So what this Gender Recognition Act did was to then grant legal right in the name of this thing called gender or acquired gender. But it actually, what it did was to actually award those legal rights on the, in fact,
impact in terms of whether someone is recognised as male or female. So it kind of conflates and confuses these two different aspects, which is something that's very important. So what does this? In what way was this recognition granted? And again, I think if we think about this term gender recognition, it seems a rather bizarre term, because if we talk about sex recognition, I mean, that's something that midwives do all the time. And as do kind of new mothers and fathers, they don't need a doctor to actually assign a sex to the child. In the overwhelming number of cases, it's totally obvious whether that newborn infant is male or female. There are a tiny, tiny proportion of the population that are intersex, but when we're talking about transgenderism, we're not talking about intersex, we're talking about male-bodied individuals, formerly known as men, who are demanding recognition as female or maybe some other these more recent gender categories, such as non-binary, and vice versa. Okay, so what does the Gender Recognition Act do? Well, it grants legal recognition on the basis of this applied gender, as long as you meet certain conditions. The first is that you have to be living in this acquired gender for 2 years and have evidence and some documented evidence around that. Again, quite what that means, we've raised questions about all of this, what does that mean to be living in this acquired gender? I have yet to have any kind of definition of that kind of term that does not thoroughly rely on some gender stereotypes and gender expectations. The second criteria is that an individual have to be under some kind of medical supervision and have a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. That might involve some kind of hormonal intervention, it might involve some kind of surgical intervention, but it does not need to. So someone can gain recognition as the other sex without having any kind of hormone regime, and certainly without having any surgical interventions. And we know that 4 out of 5 men who now are living as women actually retain their full male genitalia. So that is something I think is something we need to be aware of. There's the whole issue of marriage. So according to the Gender Recognition Act, somebody who wants to be recognised in the other sex needs to be unmarried or have a spouse who's willing to consent to changing the marriage to a same-sex basis. They have to be over 18, and they have to declare that they intend to live the rest of their life in this acquired gender. So basically what you've got is a whole set of, you've got this legal recognition, and then you've got a number of kind of checks and balances that involve medical supervision before this is awarded by this gender recognition panel. Okay, so just a few things to note about why this is problematic. As I said already, and as Trix has mentioned, there's a conflation of sex and gender, which is I think is very problematic in terms of increasing so with the new legislation proposals. The feminist analysis and even social science analysis of sex and gender was totally sidelined in the development of this legislation. It was not recognised. Now, given that we live in a patriarchy, which a lot of people, including trans activists, seem to be rather fond of ignoring that particular fact, we live in a male-dominated society where men, as a class, have social and economic power in a way that political power and cultural power in a way that women do not. I think this kind of sidelining of this distinction between sex and gender is particularly problematic for women. So all the implications for women of this kind of legislation has not been considered. And really importantly, what that Gender Recognition Act did was to establish the concept of transgenderism and the idea that someone can be transgender. It establishes that as a basis for legal rights. Now that, I think, is something that we really need to think about very carefully, because it's very different to say that if I perceive a particular individual, so a male-bodied individual, and I can say, this is a man who is presenting in feminine attire and perhaps, some kind of what you understand to be feminine dresses, and is demanding rights to be recognised as a woman, that is a very, very different statement to saying that is a transgender woman. And why is it that only one of those statements is permissible? And I'd like to draw your attention to a really perceptive quote that goes back quite a few years now, to 2000, by Carla Mantilla, who says that identity politics is a stealth maneuver that demands in the name of tolerance that others do not challenge my equality. And I think what we're seeing here is that a demand in the name of equality that others do not challenge that demand. That's a really, really crucial thing, I think, to understand. Okay, I've taken far too much time already, seeing that I've set this limit of quarter two. So I'm just going to skim very briefly through. What the Equality Act of 2010 did was to introduce gender reassignment as a protected characteristic in all equality legislation in terms of protection from discrimination, etc. The Equality Act is kind of topped and tailed by these two international declarations, the Yogyakarta Principles and the Council of Europe Resolution 2048, which really served to embed this notion of gender identity and the idea that the idea of self-determination or self-declaration, that we are all entitled to have our gender, assuming that such a thing is recognised by our determination, our declaration of that. And we can see that that's what really fed into the Maria Miller Report of 2016, and which is now feeding into this proposed review. So just very briefly then, in terms of the Maria Miller Report, the Transgender Equality Report of 2016, just to say that women's voices were really overwhelmingly ignored in the production of that report. There were a couple of very, very brief protections from organisations, but none of us were invited to come and testify at the hearings in the way that transgender activists and transgender groups were. It was a very wide-reaching report that included 71 conclusions and recommendations over a wide range of policy areas. And two of the really main things that report did was to make this shift from the language of gender reassignment to gender identity, to really champion this notion of self-declaration, to streamline the process of legal recognition in terms of applied gender, get rid of all the medical checks and balances, make it a much more straightforward and, by the sound of it, fairly administrative process. And it also introduced the notion of the so-called non-binary and other genders and these kind of recognition things, which, as I say, given that the whole thing is based on a faulty definition, all of these things, I think, are very problematic. So this the proposal now for this review of the gender recognition really comes on the back of that, and we've got politicians, you know, falling over themselves to champion this, and I think it really says a lot about the status of women in our society that really no politicians today have really seriously taken on board what the implications are for women, and I hope that is now, I think we are at a turning point where that is starting to change, because so what they're looking at is to remove the need for medical diagnosis of gender dysphoria, to streamline and accelerate the process, and to really promote and enshrine this principle of self-declaration so that someone can change their gender, or in fact legally have a change of sex recognised, simply through that process of self-declaration. So there's a huge number of implications for women and children as well, particularly young people, for all of that. So I'm going to hand over now to... to be doing about all of that. So I'm really pleased that for once in this room, women's voices are being represented. And I believe that the phrase goes, for the many, not the few.
Thanks, Julia. I just want to assert, first of all, my right to speak. To say that I'm really grateful to the organisers of the event, because it's really good that we have this event on the fringe of the Labour Party at this conference, and we have got gone ahead and got our voice out there. So well done to everyone, Trixie, for organising the event. I think that one of the things that we need to make clear to everybody is our right to free speech, as I've said. And there is tyranny surrounding this debate. It's really important that we assert that women have got the right to have an opinion on this matter. And we do need to consider why we've got to the point where there is a resurgent left, and I am a socialist feminist, and I do see this as a really important moment for us. But we've got to the point of there being a resurgent left that actually the voice of women in that is being silenced. And I think that everyone here who's a Labour Party member, who's a socialist, who's on the left, that should be something of major concern. And I just wanted to go to the events of the 13th of September and what happened there. Clearly, what happened was a concerted attempt, not just a one-off incident of a feminist being assaulted for going to a feminist meeting that discussed the issues of gender and sex and what those things are, which is just the normal everyday occurrence of feminism in this country. The assault for going to that meeting, actually there had been intimidation, there had been a campaign of silencing people as they went up to that point. The meeting space had been closed down. There had been a campaign on social media of assaulting so-called Turks. And of course, in that climate, we have got to get to the point where we say, we have got the right to speak. Free speech for women is absolutely central. So we've got, clearly, online and elsewhere in real life, rhetoric that is going on around this debate that is actually really unhelpful and closing it down. And, you know, I'm here in the Labour movement to say to you that, you know, anybody that you see or hear utilising the term turf or calling for violence against women who have certain opinions are insistent on this debate taking place and are told to shut up, that you also become brave. We don't just leave this for the feminists to be uplifting. It has got to stop. And you have got to take part in that. I know that most of you will know this already, and that we have, you know, people who have been campaigning, women who have been campaigning on this issue now for many years. Solidarity to them. Thank you very much. But I didn't want to read out some of this language that surrounds this debate that's on social media. You've heard it, but I want to read this out for the press. So we have somebody who is non-binary or transgender of some sort saying, imagine if 20 people had punched turfs. This is after the 13th. Imagine if every turf had been left bruised and bloodied. Every one of them would stop organising. So it's an incitement to violence against feminists. It has to be called out for what it is. I heard a turf got punched, so it's my duty as commander of armchair violence enthusiast Twitter to say, good job, nice work, keep it up. I mean, this is, and it's, you know, it's absolutely everywhere. It would be nice if there were roving gangs of trans women beating the shit out of transphobes, but alas, this doesn't seem to be the case. If every time a turf opened her mouth, they got a fist in it, they wouldn't open her fucking mouth. And the importance of this meeting to say we are not having it is absolutely fundamental. Anybody here who thinks that this is a transphobic meeting or whatever, it's a meeting of turfs, so even though there's a small protest outside, that despite the threats, despite the intimidation, we will persist.
Yeah.
All of us will persist in this, and we will also win this.
carry on.
And that is also a warning to those people who've got large social media platforms who think they can get away with it. Well, you cannot.
Yes.
So, to the issue and question, and we, you know, have said we want a calm, rational debate. Obviously, there's a lot of emotion surrounding it, and we are insistent that this debate will take place. And we want a respectful debate. And I do think, you know, we need to reiterate that we do not in any way condone discrimination or violence or harassment or any form of intimidation against trans people. That is not what this is about. It's balancing rights of two groups of people. So we want to have a proper discussion of what is proposed in the idea that it becomes easier for people to change gender or self-identify. I've handed out a brief of our campaign that I'm organising with other feminists, or a woman's place. Look at that, to follow us on Twitter and on Facebook and so on. But this campaign basically is going back to basics of why it is important for women to have a woman's place and assert the right to safe spaces for women. So it's actually looking at things in the law around exemptions. These already exist. So in law, you can have exemptions to say there are certain services, certain jobs, certain roles that have got to be female, not so much male only, and that those need protecting. And I think it's important that I just make it clear what kind of jobs we're talking about, because in service, when we put this to women, about do you think this should be a woman-only role, 97% of them say yes. So this, you know, for politicians, is a light bulb moment. Women want these services, and they think these jobs should be for them. So it's things like carer for an elderly woman or a disabled woman, midwife, breastfeeding counsellor, rape crisis counsellor, bar officer, prison security officers who carry out searches, supervisory teachers or youth leaders on residential trips. All of those we think the law should continue to allow exemptions.
And all women's shortlist, which is a pension benefit law, I have to add, which has already been flouted.
Yep, we've got our representation, we've got in our demands reserved places in political parties and organisations or winning only shortlists. Because it's important in a country where we have less than 50% of parliament of women representatives that is not further eroded by this agenda. And furthermore, obviously there are services around intimate clinical services that women have got the right to have female practitioners who are accessing those services for them and administering those services. So these are the things that we're talking about, and I think that anybody who has got an outsider, a rational view of what the situation is, will completely understand that that is a reasonable agenda, yet we are silenced on it. So we, as I said, are determined to get these points across in the consultation process, and very much hope that you can join us in campaigning around those issues. So I just want to finish really quickly on the climate. As I said, I'm a socialist feminist. I think it's really important that the socialist agenda also embraces this agenda that we're talking about here. I did take some optimism from John McDonnell's speech when he did make reference to women and austerity and the kind of backlash that's being faced for women. But he also made specific reference to the fact that every piece of legislation that's introduced through the Parliament by a Labour government will be scrutinised for its impact on women. And that actually wasn't written into the first script of his speech, which was given to the press. And I think that's a sign of us having an impact, that they are starting to listen, and so we have to continue listening, because we are not going away.
I'm going to just read this out, actually, because I know I haven't got much time, and I want to go through all of the impacts.
A bit louder.
That's only the camera. Before I change this into the room, it's just to make the progress. It's just to the...
Right. But how self-declared gender identity as a protected characteristic in law would affect children and families. In fact, the whole of society, and I think people have no idea what the effects will actually be. If it's established in law as a protected characteristic in place of gender reassignment as it is currently, it will legally apply to children of any age. The proposed legislation would affect not only those children suffering gender dysphoria, and that's the medical term, which means discomfort, distress around your gender, accompanied by the feeling that you are or the desire to be the opposite sex. It will affect every child in the country through the inevitable expansion of a re-education programme in schools, which is already established through organisations such as GIAS, Gendered Intelligence, Educate and Celebrate, Stonewall, the CPS, and numerous local councils and LGBT organisations across the UK. The effect on parents' rights will be profound. The legislation would effectively prevent anyone, teachers, doctors, child professionals, from ever questioning a child's belief that they are the opposite sex. Parents might still get away with it privately at home, but in the case of custody battles, it may be a factor in family court decisions about where to place a child. If one parent affirms the child and the other parent doesn't. Parents who don't want their child to learn anti-science theories under the guise of facts may find that very difficult to challenge when those ideas are presented within anti-bullying programmes within schools. Parents will have no control over a school which affirms their daughter as a boy against their will. This legislation would have a serious impact on the freedom of parents to bring up a child in the way they see fit, in this case with the knowledge of basic human biological reality and a real understanding of the difference between gender and sex. The effects on gender dysphoric children themselves. Let's start by saying actually to call a child transgender is both to make a diagnostic assumption and a prediction about that child's future. Transgender is not a clinical diagnosis, but it's almost become a political label which assumes no other reason for a cross-sex identity in a child. A meta-analysis of all published research studies of children with gender dysphoria shows that 80% will naturally come to accept the sex they were born. This is true of even some of the most severe cases, and there's no established criteria to judge which children will persist and which will desist. Affirmation would be enshrined as the only lawful response to a trans-identified child. The affirmation model is based not on research or any evidence, but is a product of a hard-fought campaign by trans activists based on the premise that a child knows him or herself best. And of course, a four-year-old only knows himself as a four-year-old. A teenage girl only knows herself as a teenager. Absolute certainty that you will never change is a symptom of childhood and adolescence. In practice, it means that a physician must only agree with the patient's self-diagnosis, even if the patient is only 4 years old or is a troubled autistic teenager. Affirmation and social transition of, for example, a little boy creates the fear of puberty in that boy, which he now believes is the wrong one. Puberty blockers thus supply the answer to a creative problem. Blockers prevent sexual maturation of the child in order to ostensibly buy time. But as 90% of children on blockers at the Tavistock Clinic in London progressed to cross-sex hormones at age 16, blockers clearly work to prevent children changing their minds and create persistence. The surge in sex hormones at puberty, in normal puberty, triggers the enormous changes in the teenage brain, which don't complete their job until around the age of 25. The brain personality is not fully formed until now. We don't know the effects of blockers on the developing prefrontal cortex, although there are recent studies which suggest a drop in 8 IQ points, and we know that there is research on older men who use the drug for prostate cancer, which indicate there's a risk of memory loss and depression. We're beginning to see studies which show long-term serious health effects for women who are administered blockers for precocious puberty. Both puberty blockers and cross-sex hormones are used off-label for gender-dysphoric children. Preventing a child's sexual development in early puberty followed at 16 by cross-sex hormones results in certain sterility. Enshrining in law an approach which discounts any other reason for cross-sex identity in childhood will obviously lead to greater numbers of children on the path of lifetime medication with well-documented risks to health, but no research into long-term effects. In other words, this is a non-evidence-based practice. The effects on the gay and lesbian community we are seeing, and particularly on lesbians, that cross-sex identity in childhood is overwhelmingly predictive of gay or lesbian sexual orientation in adulthood, not transsexualism. Affirming a child's gender identity can therefore be seen as a new form of gay conversion therapy and gay eugenics. There's been over a 1,000% increase in children referred to the Tavistock Clinic in London over the past 6 years. These figures are inflated by the unprecedented rise in the number of teenage girls. Over 70% of adolescent referrals are girls. 48% of whom have co-occurring mental health issues. 50% of all children referred to the Tavistock over the years test positive for autism traits. Recent reports of girls' mental health, including Girl Guide and UK's Girls Attitude Survey, indicate that girls and young women in the UK are in crisis. Reports such as Stonewall's recent Schools Report 2017, which indicate high suicidal ideation in trans youth, simply serve to cover up the fact that the majority of these youngsters will be teenage girls, now collated in statistics as trans boys. These girls are now hidden. We're aware that teenagers and young adults are susceptible to indoctrination, brainwashing, and social contagion. We try to protect them from anorexia and self-harm sites, but we're not concerned that the internet is packed with Tumblr bloggers and YouTube bloggers with tens of thousands of followers who are selling young people the myth of transformation through medical mutilation of their healthy bodies and a lifetime's dependency on powerful off-label hormones with irreversible effects. A PSHE teacher and head of year in a large comprehensive told me that in her school, the kids who identified as trans are, without exception, either lesbian, autism spectrum, or have suffered previous sexual abuse. Gender identity as a protected characteristic prevents us from exploring any of these underlying reasons for gender dysphoria, which will therefore remain hidden. To take at face value, any child or adolescent's gender identity is a failure of duty of care towards vulnerable children and young people, and more cases of future regret will be inevitable. And we see more and more, and again, mostly young women. But the effects of this proposed legislation won't just affect those children who are identified as trans, they will affect every other child in the UK. To teach children in schools, as we are now doing, that their authentic self is something in their head split off from and in opposition to the body is to create gender dysphoria. Mind-body disassociation is recognised as a state of mental ill health, but in this case it is presented as something to be celebrated. gender identity has only ever been used in child development tests in the sense of a child understanding which sex they are. So a child understands their gender identity by the age of three means a child by the age of three knows if they're a boy or a girl. That's what it means. The term has been appropriated to mean an internal, innate state of gender, a kind of brain state, a concept which has no evidence to back it. Children are being misled into believing that their gender identity is a material reality, that if they feel like a man, they are literally male, that if they feel like a woman, they are literally female, and if they feel non-binary, they are literally neither male nor female. And this is what we are legislating for. Since we have been teaching children that they need a gender identity, calls to Childline from young people confused about their gender have shot up. So Childline now gets 8 calls a day from young children worried about their gender. The concept of gender identity is clearly causing mental health problems for young people. Let's have some talk through some examples in schools.
We've actually gone slightly over time. I'm going to let Stephanie finish.
Does anyone want to go for it?
Sorry?
If anyone wants to leave, they have to go now.
Yeah, it's because it's 10 to, but I'm going to let Stephanie finish and then we'll have a natural break and we'll go on to the discussion if for whoever can stay.
No one's going.
I'll go through this really quick.
When a six-year-old
boy comes back to school in a dress and the teachers tell all the children he's now a girl, the other girl's sense of their own reality is shattered. What is the secret to being a real girl if female biology is irrelevant? The trans girl becomes the most special girl in the class. Inevitably, the girls must look to him to find out what makes you a girl. Inevitably, they will only find stereotypes of dress, toy choices, and interests. The superficial gender constraints and stereotypes are reinforced in girls' minds as the reality. This ideology, because it's a belief, it's an idea, it has no basis in science, teaches all children that the gender and sexual stereotypes which are harmful, especially for girls, are the true immutable reality, and biological sex is an illusion. These sexist stereotypes are taught directly in schools through GIAS teaching resources, which claim that girls have pink brains and boys have blue brains, and those brains sometimes end up in the wrong bodies. We don't know how this will impact on the developmental stage of learning to distinguish between fantasy and reality. The children are no longer permitted to recognise reality, and nor do we know the long-term psychological effects on children. Because children are being subject to relentless gender identity propaganda throughout the media, in particular the BBC, schools, even Childline, if they call for advice, debate is not allowed and no other viewpoints are given to the child, which is in contravention of the UN rights of the child. Allowing boys and adult males into organisations for only girls would be legally enforced, despite the advertisement of these organisations as for girls only, as Girl Guide in UK already does. The deception of girls would be a legal requirement. Normal child safeguarding procedures would become unlawful. The biology curriculum in schools would have to change to include no reference to male, female, man or woman in biology texts on how babies are made. All children would be misinformed about human reproduction, but in reality, again, it is girls who will be denied the language to talk about their female biology, as we already see happening. If male pupils are allowed access to girls' toilets or toilets in their unisex, then girls may avoid using the toilet or even avoid using school altogether when they're menstruating out of embarrassment or shame. If an adolescent male is allowed to compete in girls' sports teams or use the girls' changing rooms, more girls may give up sport. Likewise, if male pupils are allowed to take part in initiatives designed to advance girls in so-called male areas, such as STEM subjects, girls may just give up trying. If teenage girls must consent to a male classmate using their toilets and changing rooms, they learn that their boundaries may be violated and their consent is unimportant. Girls learn that they are not always allowed to say no. This is grooming. Any lessons on the importance of consent are meaningless. In the case of public swimming pool changing rooms, a young girl cannot name a male with a penis as a man. Voyeurism and indecent exposure cease to exist as crimes if a man identifies as a woman. Girls may even put themselves in risky situations with any man who claims to be a woman, out of fear of being seen as transphobic. If girls coerced into accepting that a penis is a female sex organ when attached to a male who identifies as a woman, young lesbians will continue to be horrendously bullied and accused of transphobia if they don't accept men with penises who identify as lesbians as sexual partners. Proposed UK law will strengthen the position of the males in this situation. Girls will be brought up to be conditioned into this, which I think we are already seeing. They will grow up to not have the same rights as our generation have had, but not even to recognise that those rights exist.
Yeah.